I would call upon Mr. Ramesh Iyengar, who is immediate past president of STC, and he is the senior manager at Persistent Pune. Nivedita, please. I would request Mr. Ramesh to hand over a small token of expression. Thank you, Nivedita. Thank you so much. I would request all of you to assemble in the ground floor for a group photograph. Please, after that we can gather.
Yes, that's better. Welcome back after lunch. Now we have Jaya Chaudhary, who is going to present on customer focus documentation. Jaya Chaudhary is working with Siemens. She will be giving more introduction about her.
Task-based, customer task-based, okay, next, user experience, okay, quality, next, precise information, okay, don't think about only technical communication, you can think about anything and everything, pardon, return of investments, perfectly fine, next,
troubleshooting information,
okay, I'll quickly go on to this, involvement. Customer wants the people at the our end also to get involved. Why? Because they want us to understand what is the value for the customer and whether they are providing that value or not. That can be money, that can be ROI, that can be quality, that can be user specifications and so on. Speed is the time to market. No customer wants to deliver a product maybe 1 month late, 1 week late. They are looking at this on-time delivery. Speed is one such thing. Availability. Today at STC India, and since the morning, whatever we spoke of, I found one common thing, and that is globalization. So the documents or the products, be it a software or a hardware, our technical documentation is not an exception. We want it to be globalized as well. So availability to the entire audience globally is also what the customer wants. Courtesy, some soft skills, honesty, satisfaction, can-do attitude. Customer does not want us to be laid back at any point of time. Always a can-do attitude is something which they always want in any technical communicator or any developer, tester, product owner, chief product owners and so on. Skill service, be it any kind of service what you're providing, you have to be skilled in the same. And the little extra which you do, that is what the customer as well wants. Last is appreciation. So these are the kind of soft skills or some parameters which get fitted into the top things that the customer wants. As you said about quality, user satisfaction, all this somewhere or the other gets segregated in all these 10 factors. Now let's move ahead and see what's the agenda for today. Since there's a time limit, 40 minutes, 30 minutes, I'll see another 10 placard going on, 10 minutes placard, 5 minutes placard going on. So I will not spend much time on what is the lean model of software development lifecycle, but I'll definitely touch upon the fact. And then I'll give the highlights of the lean software development, then move on to what has been the documentation process in the lean model. It will be presented to you as a case study. The 3 years work which we have done, the pitfalls, the drawbacks, the goodness of it, all will be reflected in this number three. And number four, the takeaway, and how you as a technical communicator, even if you do not have a lean model of development in place in your organization, you can mold your documentation process to follow lean model and gain most out of it. Let's move on to what is the lean model. History and the definition. Definitely I've taken this from Wikipedia. So please, you can always read through it. But I will explain in one sentence, not more than that, what is lean manufacturing principle. Lean manufacturing principle stresses only on one thing. That you know your customer first. Second, understand what is value for the customer. What is not value for the customer, please eliminate it through the entire process. So as a documentation, the same thing applies to us. Understand what is value for the customer with respect to technical documentation. Identify what is not value for the customer. Eliminate it in the process. Second, this is definitely adapted from the Toyota production system and it is from the manufacturing background. Now what happens when it comes to the software development? Definitely it is written, originated in a book written by Mary and Tom. And what they did was, they understood the software development lifecycle. And same thing they did in the software development lifecycle. They identified what is the value for the customer with respect to a software. And then, where is the waste created? With respect to the process, with respect to the resources, with respect to all the kinds of, to the entire software development lifecycle in each and every aspect, in each and every step. Wherever there is a waste, please eliminate the same. And that is all about the lean software development. Now what are the five principles of lean? First, I will use this word day in and day out when I'm explaining lean, because that is the crux, value. You have to understand what is the one thing with a value that a customer wants, because customers are different. Today, if you are a customer of a mobile, which you're using, what do you perceive? For you, usability comes first, the user experience comes first. If you're using something different, a fridge, maybe what you look at it is different. You are not then looking at the user experience. You are using most probably, okay, how much cooling does it give? What kind of space is it covering? So there are different aspects. So whatever you're writing for, the product you are writing for, the most important thing is first know for the customer, what is the customer actually looking for? What is the value, meaning or value for the customer? Next, value streaming. Now, once you know what is a customer needs, second, go back to the process which you follow. Go through the entire process. Break down your tasks into further small denomination of tasks. Then understand, in all these tasks, is there something which is creating a waste of time and effort? Eliminate it. That is known as a value streaming. I'll give more information on the same when I do a case study from Siemens. Flow cleanly from start to finish. An apt example would be, there has been times where the requirements engineering has been done. You go back to the development and once the testing starts, something goes wrong and the customer during a demo says, this is not what we want. And then you go back to rework and a lot of things comes into place. What is happening? It is not flowing cleanly from straight start to the finish. That is what we want in lean. It should flow from start to the finish. Next is, of course, perfection. It's not an exception in lean. Everywhere you require the perfection and you can only do it by continuously improving the same. Last, pull. Value is one thing. Another is what pulls the customer. What is the showstopper for the customer? Complete that requirement first. That is what is pulling the customer. Maybe out of 5 requirements, there will be 2 requirements that will be a showstopper for the customer. So first, you have to identify value and next will be the pull. Let's see what's the highlights of the lean software development. First thing, the development team structure was modified. How? This is a schematic diagram of explaining how the product team structure was modified. There's a product, and the product is huge. And there are different subcomponents of the products. So the product was divided into the subcomponents, and based on the subcomponents, the tag teams was formed. That is, individual teams who can work on those components and complete the requirements without depending on each other. One team need not depend on the other to complete a requirement. They can do it on their own. So that was the formation. And what is TACT? TACT is derived from a German word called as TACZIT. I'm from Siemens, European German organization. So I'll boost off that. And what is it coming from is cycle time. It's like a sprint. You talk about sprint, so here we talk about TACT. And next, from the customer team, we have two people. One is the chief product owner, then comes a product owner, who are our interface between the customer and us. And next would be the development team, in which we have a part product owners as well. And then has the core development team, in which we will have the tag team speaker. It's like a lead. You have a tag team of around 5 or 6 people, among which one person will be a speaker, who will be like a team lead, who will delegate tasks as well, ensure that all the tasks in the tag team is completed. And then you have supports, developers and testers. Next, we have some streamlined roles for the product development team. The team structure, hierarchy, chief product owner. Then we have the product owners. We have the part product owners and then respective tag team speakers. This is the structure for the development team. Next time come to a team known as an expert team member. Here arises a difference, which you do not see in the Scrum model of Agile. And what's the difference is, you now have an expert team which comprises of, yes, the product owners, part product owners, but additionally, one member for each of this, architecture, system test automation, quality, usability, configuration management, and UDoc, nothing but user documentation. That I'm proud of, because we are now a part of the expert team who are a part of the requirement meeting, who are a part of the TACT kickoff meetings, TACT analysis review meetings, each and every meetings from the start to the finish, we are a part of it. Then comes the developers. In the development team, we have identified one person who will be a representative for the central function process. How? We have someone from architecture who will have a good knowledge about the architecture and will assist and work with the architects. We will have somebody who will work with the CM executive, that's from the configuration management. There will be an expert who will be a kind of a person who will gather all the usability requirements and speak to the usability team. There will be also a person for the user documentation to give us the time. He will have the effort allotted. Why is it important? Because often we have come across where we hear that developers do not have time. Yesterday, too, in a pre-conference workshop, there was a lady who said that, I faced so much difficulty in gaining requirements that I was about to cry. Imagine the plight of that lady, that she might have gone through so much ordeal that she was not given any input from any of the developers, I think months after months, and her deliverable was not at the right moment, very at the right moment. So here we have got a good support from the development team because they have been allotted effort. You have 5 hours of effort for a particular task and you have to help the user documentation team out. So that is one good thing which we have in place. Now next, what are the new processes which we got? One, the release was divided into two things, development tax, hardening tax. Development tax, it can vary from 3 to 4 development tax, where only development is happening, and along with that, a testing of that requirement also gets completed. Hardening test is completely only testing of the requirement. Backlog requirement document, it's very similar to the feature specifications or the DVS, where we have the entire requirement written precisely from architecture point of view, design point of view, usability point of view, user documentation point of view as well. So you get the entire information of the requirements right out there in BLRD. Then we have something known as stack kickoff meeting. So it's also similar to any kickoff meeting in the process where we come to know of the first in the release kickoff, what will we do in the entire release. Second, in the TACT kickoff meeting, we get to know what will we do per TACT. TACT analysis review meeting, STAR meeting, where we get to know that what have we done good in the past TACT, or what are our concerns, why can we improve, and so on. Functional document for user documentation, I'll definitely get into the in-depth of it when I describe the user documentation processes. So I'll leave it here for now. So we have something known as stacked board, where we have something open and then we have in progress and closed. So people during the stand-up meeting, they go and they paste their cards over there, their tasks, and move it from one state to the other. We have stand-up meetings as well, and this is no different from the Scrum model of Agile. So I will not go in depth of it. Release criteria board, very, 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 very important thing. Why? I cannot release my documentation if, as you see, there's something known as A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. This actually will be replaced by the name of the component of the project. So we have something known as SciChem UDoc as the project which I work for. So for the other project also, it can be A, B, C, UDoc. So this are nothing but the graph which shows the defect analysis. So today, if I have four defects open in priority three, it will be a big red mark over there. And I'll get a good call from the product owner saying that you have to reduce it, we cannot release the product, and so on. So we have to put it all down to zero. So for the product to get released, the RCB must be all green in all respect of components, not only user documentation. Let's come to the interesting part where I'll spend some time, and that's documentation process in the lean model. So how are we doing? Let us first look what new features did we get. First was the modification of the documentation development lifecycle. I always say in most of the organization, we have to get aligned to the development lifecycle. So same was with Lean. We have to mend our documentation processes so that we could align align to the Lean model of development lifecycle. And the introduction of the role of user documentation expert also defined roles and responsibilities for us. We were not sidelined now. I really repeat it because I feel it from the heart that being aligned to the Lean model, we got the visibility and not sidelined to any kind of a process. Here we were a part of the complete planning team where we had the defined roles and responsibilities as well. We were visible to the entire stakeholders as well. All the ownership, all the decisions were in our hand with respect to user documentation, and we were being heard. We were the part of the demos. No demos were successful until unless we given online help or a document to show that yes, this is a document that will be there for the requirement. They used to ask for the user documentation. We got comments such as, this is the first time in 10 years when we see a user documentation being displayed during the demo. So that was all the accomplishments which we did during this process. Increased responsibilities, of course. I always use this quote. Recently I did during one of my other presentation also. My and my son's favorite character is Spider-Man. So I believe in one quote. With great power comes great responsibilities. So it is bound to be there. We got the power of being an UDoc expert. Responsibilities also were there. We were questionable. So it's fine. Introduction of FDUD. As I said, FDUD stands for Functional Document for User Documentation. It is a template which contains a lot of questions. What is the feature about? What has the user to consider, like prerequisites? What is the workflow of the feature? Then is there any dependency? So there are a lot of questions like this, and the developers need to fill the answer. Of course, they will write in developer's language, no comments about it. It's your responsibility to change it. It's the first who is affected, delegating it to another or myself, and then estimating for which tact has it to be released, when will the review be conducted, put all the defects in place. So all this was done in plan and estimate the scope for the UDoc. We review the FDUD as well. We author in source language and translate the documents in target languages from either internal or external translators. We review and translate the UI messages. This is also another new thing. We, together with the usability team, we review the user interface messages. Because often it is seen user interface messages, if the text will be like, please do this, exclamation mark. Why is the exclamation mark at the end? I cannot understand. The usage of punctuation marks are very horrible. There is no comma before an introductory phrase. So we all stepped in here, I think 2 years back, when we started working with the usability team and came up with the process where we review and translate UI messages effectively as well. Track and fix defects, that's the normal thing. CM tasks, we have a lot of configuration management tasks which an UDoc expert also has to do, that is merging the document to the integration build, ensuring that it is in the proper server locations, manage the clear case tasks as well. So there are miscellaneous configuration management tasks as well. Migration, yes, with authoring we are also involved in the migration of the content from one tool to the other, either manually or automated. Now, quick briefly, I will look into what is the methodology of creating software documentation in Lean. Analysis, yes, we review the BLRD. We attend the release kickoff to understand the entire requirements and we create the documentation requirements backlog. Coming to the content development phase, we review the UI messages and this is every tact. Because the first and foremost rule for us in Lean was that we have to create a usable documentation at the end of every tact. It means with the end of a realization of a requirement, our documentation is also completed. So we review the UI messages, we review the FTUD, understand the requirement through the developers, demos, author it. The technical review is done by the developers and testers and the product owners here. We finalize the source content. We use the documentation in the final feature demo, as I said, and merge the documents to the integration build. Code is merged, documentation is merged. Tester can test the requirement on completely. He can verify the documentation also, as well as the code. Defect fixing goes on by analyzing, fixing defects and reviewing it as well. Review phase, we have online review with the stakeholders. This happens before, little bit before the hardening tact and sometimes during the hardening tact. We address the review comments and finally merge the documents to integration build, and that's our final source document. Translation management tasks, we have a lot of pre-translation and post-translation tasks that we need to do. And content development in the hardening tact is not much. It is only for the README and some small product information manuals which we do. Otherwise, during the development tact, our authoring is done. So, last, during the document delivery, we publish the final documents and we integrate the documents again to the integration build and we generate a CMP label. That is the label to identified by the configuration management expert and then take the documents out and put it in a software DVD. So, that's an internal process. Few case studies, as I said, case study of eliminating waste. We have come up with a process of how to create UI messages with the help of usability team, development team, and this was done by value stream mapping, and it actually eliminated the wastage of 47% of the effort and the time. And this was done by me and my team. Next, we have established this, the principles of how we can pass a defect or a test case which has a user documentation impact. And this was also done by us. Then we did another process creation of how we can effectively create a process to review the FDUD so that at the end of the review cycle, the number of review comments can be reduced. Because we have often seen, we take the FDUD, we document it, then what happens is that some of the prerequisites or some of the conditions are missed out. So that could have been captured if it goes through the stakeholders at the first stage itself. So then this process was also streamlined. Finally, what do we say takeaway? Definitely, it's time to market. That's what Lean is talking about. Give the value the customer wants. Give the pull the customer wants. Eliminate waste from your process. So first and foremost thing, eliminate waste. Increase roles and responsibilities. Definitely, I agree. Not only us. All the teams, usability, architecture, developers, testers, they have a visibility, they have a team of their own. They have defined roles and responsibilities now, which gives an individual satisfaction as well. Improves knowledge and skills. Why? As I said, lean is all about continuous improvement. And change is something that is the only thing that is constant in this world. So if we continuously improve and start eliminating waste, every release from some process of our other in documentation, we can get to this, improve knowledge and skill of ours as well. Ownership, definitely. As you have a power, as you have an increased responsibility, you have an ownership of the entire documentation. Value for time and money. Again, you have eliminated waste. What you have given is value for time and money to your end customer. Improves quality. Again, as you have a stringent review process in place, as you have a stringent defect fixing phase in place, as you have a process where you cannot release a document until unless all the defects are closed and the release criteria board is green, you ought to improve the quality of your documentation as well. Now, before moving on to the question and answers, I believe, yes, we were lucky to have been allowed to the lean model. But I know there are different organizations from my past experience also where you are not aligned to any software development. You are just sidelined and you're creating your user documentation there. So create a user documentation process for yourself. Why not? Take away the theme from the lean model and create a process for yourself. I'm sure you'll be heard. Nobody is going today that go out and ask some time for the developer. You want a role from the development team? No. But at least you can take away some learnings and imbibe it into your own process. Even if you're a freelance writer, I'm sure somewhere or the other, all the learnings can be kept in place. That is what my complete motivation or the goal for today's presentation was. Whatever we have been practicing, it was a good experience for us. And if you can take away even, 30, 40, 50% of the same and imbibe it in your daily routine, I think that would really make a difference to the entire technical communication world. So, open forum. Yes, please. Right. Right.
So the same thing what you're talking and the same kind of
similar.
My main question is there also the thing is remove waste. That is the desirable industry waste just remove. How different is this from agile?
I think that is a point. Agile, I won't say it is different, that's a different model which you're using. Okay, even I have worked on agile. Absolutely. Even if you work on agile model, there I didn't see the specialized roles coming into place. Then I would say it was not an agile, even if you go for an agile model, here you do not have a place in the agile model for this expert team. That is maybe you had a team.
It would not be classified as an expert team as such, but there was a product architect, and we had POs, APOs, the terminal is licensed, but basically they're doing the same job.
See, they're doing the same job, I'm not declining it. With lean product development lifecycle, if you go on to the complete chart, it's a complete defined role for the user documentation. In Agile, we do not have that. You just have a role. I would then say you are a great team, ma'am. I don't know your name, okay. But myself in Agile, I had not such a great experience, okay. So I think you had imbibed the best of the Agile model. Scrum model, as you're saying, you're working on Agile. Maybe you imbibed both the Scrum model and Agile. Because Lean is just a form of Agile. That's what I'm saying. When you say Agile, Agile has different models. Scrum model and Lean model. What I'm speaking is also Agile. But it is a Lean model. In the Scrum model of Agile, you do not have this particular things over there. Okay? Yeah. Yes.
So do you have writers like that who don't overlap
then? No.
You have writer who overlaps?
Overlaps. We have dedicated two writers. Okay. For example, I'll give our example. We have around three components. Okay. Three, sometimes four. Okay. So for us, we have a writer who is dedicated for one or two components. We have divided it accordingly. Like I work for 1.5 component. And the other writer works for another 1.5 component. I do not interfere in his work, he does not interfere in my work. That is what we have segregated. Definitely, if I have a role of a user UDoc expert, I definitely have the role of more reviewing it, ensuring that his work is also done, the other person's work is also done. But I agree.
Yeah.
Here, because the product is huge, components are many. That is why you we zeroed in on two. And then what happens if you independent somebody, ownership comes over there. That's the reason why.
Yeah, we will take this question as the last question since we have the time constraint. Yeah. That was a very